A leak in the plans didn't breach the process, but it might be a step towards breaching the lower Snake River dams entirely. We previously reported about leaked federal documents that outline the federal government's supposed plan to restore local salmon and steelhead fish populations. And conservationists say this is an outline that the foundation for a future without the SNA, the Snake River dams. It would take studies, alternative energy sources, and a lot of money. But some say the consequences are too big to shoulder. Andrew Bartline shares the story.
World of commerce.
You're seeing the water stakeholders.
And business.
You're seeing the ag stakeholders.
Runs tight.
The power stakeholders.
On time.
Which is why our stakeholders have some serious concerns with what's been announced here with this new agreement.
Jason Mercier advocates on their behalf, which in turn puts him in opposition to the newly announced federal government's position.
Well, even if we do this, you're not going to be guaranteed those returns.
The feds officially published their plan to recover the shrinking salmon and steelhead populations. In total, it asked to earmark $1 billion to lay the foundation for a future without the lower Snake River dams.
And we have not seen an appetite in Congress to do so.
The funds are intended to supplement hatchery operations, create alternative energy sources, and study the lateral impacts.
On the economic side, the consequences are substantial.
The plan is part of a settlement in ongoing litigation between the feds and local tribes partnered with numerous conservationist groups.
You are going to impact agriculture if you drop that water table, and we're a big ag-producing area. You're going to put significant pressure on the transportation sector if you're taking all of that commodities off of barges and putting them onto the trucks on the roads. Unfortunately, this does not even settle the litigation. It just puts it on hold for 10 years.
But 10 years' time is all too routine to this team.
We and others have been suing the federal government for 25 years.
Mitch Cutter is part of a decades-long push advocating for a full breach.
We have a limited amount of time to do that, something like two generations of Chinook salmon, which are about 4 years each, so 8 years total. There's a consensus of salmon biologists that agree that we are on this extinction pathway.
But ask around. It's not the first time Jason's heard it.
In 1996, the advocates for tearing down the dam took out a full-page ad in the New York Times. The salmon would be extinct if the dams were not removed.
They said it happened by 2017.
I think we still have salmon here in 2023.
Populations of Chinook and several of the populations of steelhead here in the state are already at quasi-extinction thresholds. That means fewer than 50 fish returning to an individual stream in any given year. A landslide could take that population out. A wildfire could take that population out, and from a place where it's existed for thousands of years.
But both sides agree. Our modern way of life depends on the dams.
Energy, transportation, irrigation services, people rely on those things.
All services the feds are prepared to replace. And no matter what side you ask,
dam breaching is inevitable.
It's just a matter of time.
So this could start all over again in 10 years. If these are federally authorized dams, nothing is going to be happening to them without an act of Congress.
Governor Brad Little also weighed in on the agreement, writing in part, quote, "Instead of working together to find common ground, the signatories to the agreement pandered to their political supporters and paid no attention to the real impacts dam removal would have on Idahoans." He said, "We believe authors of this deal are genuine in their desire to do what they believe is right for constituents. Unfortunately, it appears they only listen to a select few constituents in the region while disregarding many." The top concern of the Mountain States Policy Center, and also mentioned by the governor too, revolves around what's called baseload power. It's the bare minimum needed to support the power grid. And while conservationists argue hydropower is a smaller percentage of our regional grid, MSPC says it's reliable and often a barrier against rolling blackouts, or can be if needed, I should say. But as the Biden administration has outlined, Joe, this document is preparing for a potential future where eliminating, or I guess breaching the dams would be the right verb to use, is a possibility. If Congress so chooses to do so, they want to be prepared to make that happen and fill those gaps that the dams currently fill.
It's very interesting when you bring us these stories, because admittedly, I don't know a lot about this, and I feel like a lot of Idahoans don't know a lot about this, but it's a very intricate issue that people should study up, as you highlighted. It impacts every Idahoan's life every single day.
Yeah, and it's difficult, too, to where it's like, well, this government study says that the dams are the reason the fish are dying.
Yeah.
And then somebody just says, well, I disagree with that. I think it's this reason. And so It's tough when somebody says this is the reason and then the opposition just says no, it's not. I don't know where you go from there, but the position of the federal government right now is they're interested in potentially removing the dams.
Okay, well, we'll follow this one closely. I know there's a lot of input on both sides, a lot of cases to be made. Thank you, Andrew Bartline, for digging into a tough story. Appreciate it.